I'm going to show you some props. That's a hat. That's a kerchief. That's a diaper cover. That's suspense. Now I'm going to see if we can share, because I have, of course, a PowerPointless presentation, because that's what everybody has. And mine is definitely a PowerPointless presentation because it was done on a Mac Keynote program. So you folks are traction railroad types. I am a mountain climbing railroad type. And again, I appreciate the opportunity to talk about the Cog Railway, which just celebrated its 150th anniversary. But what I'm going to talk about is going to happen just before the 100th anniversary. And with luck, I'll be able to talk over my audio. Okay, this was my full-scale train set that I got to play on from 1953 to 1967. It's over 3 miles long. It had featured 7 steam-powered trains. Was the first of its kind. The engines left every hour on the hour, hauling passengers, used 1,000 gallons of water, 1 ton of coal, and was staffed by over 100 true characters that worked each summer. And this was my father's, Norman Jitney Lewis's, engine, the Great Gulf. Now, I know in this era, people are always worried about, can I trust this person? And as I'm a former journalist at WCAX-TV and WDEV, I understand that questioning, trust but verify. So here are my bona fides. That's my dad, that's my mom, and that's me in the summer of 1953. I would point out that the cap and the kerchief I've already shown you earlier, so I definitely am that guy. Now, I grew up at the Cog Railway. I fired my first trip at age 11, and I shoveled 1 ton of coal, and this project that I've been doing for the last 5 years got started about that time, as the owner of the railway asked my dad to write an operating manual for publication in 1964. And the manual would put the knowledge of senior engineer Mike Boyce and others down on paper. Before the book, the operational guidelines were duplicated in the early 60s and handed out to the employees. But exactly how to, it basically told you the rules and guidance for being a good brakeman, a good fireman, a good engineer, but exactly how to operate a train was left to the oral tradition, because each engine was different. These are the controls of the No. 6 Great Gulf. And if you learned the No. 6, then you might be able to run this one. And now that you've had the opportunity to see 2 diagrams, are you ready to run this one? Now, cog engines could climb because of the following common components. The cylinders did the drive gear, and the drive gear was geared down at a 5-to-1 ratio by the spur gear. And then the power was transferred to the cog gear that went into the center rack, which these days they explain it, if you had laid down a bicycle chain on the track, and then you just put your sprockets in the center and you roll on up. There was on each car a ratchet system, pawl and ratchet system, a safety device, which meant if on the way up, it would stop within an inch or so of falling back onto it. And every axle had brakes on it. The cars were pushed one car to one engine, and they were not attached. They were basically pushed up, and on the way down, they were on their own. The brakeman was responsible for keeping the weight off the engine depending upon the steepness of the grade. It's been said that a really good brakeman could stay off the engine and put an egg between the roller and the bumper and not have it actually go bad. This publication project started in 1962 for publication in 1964. But as you know, things can happen. So when my dad turned 86, I said, "You're not going to be on the planet much longer. We need to finish this." He agreed, but he said I needed to include material from my first act of journalism that I committed at Mount Washington. I had a weekly employee newsletter called the Cog Clatter, which followed in the footsteps of Henry Burt's Among the Clouds, and a one-year summertime operation by Pat Carlisle, Richard Carlisle, who went on to win awards at the Patriot Ledger in Massachusetts. That's the young man to the right on the bottom, standing with Frank Burt, who was Henry Burt's son. The cool thing was that each of these papers only cost a dime, although I have started to do calculations of what a dime in 1877 was worth, and that was a pretty good price. So taking the few names that I had in my newsletter, I had about 100, 125, I decided to do up a Cog roster, figure out where had the people go in order to try to untangle the myths and the stories and all that other stuff. I started putting together an aggregated timeline. After I looked at all of the photos and all of the names, I got a little punchy. And so when I did the images for the covers of the book, because so many photos have been taken, I did a little photoshopping. The woman in the cab is Samantha Slattery. That means that she was in the 1990s. The guy in front of the below the number nine, he's in the 1870s. The guy on the back brake platform is from the 1870s. The modern engine is looking as if it can go up the original trestle over the Amanoosuc in the 1870s. And so I put this in only because I've gone to historical societies, I've shown them the picture, and they go, "I've never seen that picture before." And I go, "I know." Likewise, everybody took pictures from above the base station on the hill there. So I thought it would be good to merge the 1870s base with the modern base of the current diesels. And that continues to change. So those are the what I started on. And I soon learned that I was actually doing something called a prospography, which was a study of people in a group, identifying patterns, connections, and a collective biography. And I need your help because I figure there could be as many as 10,000 employees of the Mount Washington Cog Railway from 1866 forward. I have just over 2,600 names and trying to get bios and pictures for all of them. You will be able to help me because many of the Coggers came from or would work during the other seasons, not the summer season, but would work on the St. J and LC, the B&M, the Grand Trunk, and I've learned about them and got some of that, but there are probably more who came to work at the mountain. Now, Sylvester Marsh's idea was considered crazy, though he did get a charter from New Hampshire legislature in 1866. He started whacking his way through what used to be a bridle path to the base of the ridge where the bridle path went up next to the Amanoosuc River. They built a log cabin and proceeded to build a test track to demonstrate his idea because nobody thought you could climb a mountain. Well, he climbed the mountain, and suddenly people wanted to invest, specifically railroad people. And so there grew this little place that was the first base depot of the Mount Washington Railway. And then they needed to try to get a traction train to the base to deliver tourists. And they wanted to get bypass the coaches. And so they started building a spur line from Fabian to the base, but it couldn't go over 6% grade, and it couldn't make it up the last bit. So they needed to then extend the track back to a place where the traction railroad, the Mount Washington Loco on the left there in the platform, and the passengers would get out, cross over the platform, hop on the cog trains, and head up to the summit. Now, all of this occurred exactly where the little transfer that was built occurred, right where I lived during my childhood summers on Cabin Row, across from the shops of the Jitney years. But this is the transfer area. I think they called it Amanusic Station for a while. And when they get on, they go up, they go through the original. And then in 1895, this section here burned. And suddenly they decided to bring the shops and all of the buildings and the boarding house. And in 1896, put in this facility that was still there when the Jitney years occurred between 1950 and 1967. But the actual start, and once they had that spur line in, it was possible for a passenger to get on in Boston in the morning and come up through New Hampshire and then get on the Wing Road that took you to Fabian and then out to the spur line and go to the Cog Railway. And you could have breakfast in Boston and supper at the summit of Mount Washington, which was a big tourist deal. Now, where it really all started was where the Red Arrow is, the base station. This is 1866. This is the test track that Sylvester Marsh built. And in August of 1866, a bunch of railroad people came up and Sylvester Marsh there circled, proved that you could use the Hero engine on the left and take passengers up a grade and bring them down safely. And that started and became the base station of the 1950s where we were, because it was a successful test in 1866. In 1867, there was suddenly money to build the first mile up to what's known as Wombeck, which where during the Jitney years, you'd take on water so that you could have a total batch of 1,000 gallons to get up and down with your steam. 1868, they tackled the next section, which was from Wombeck towards the summit. And that included the steepest grade on the line, which was at Jacob's Ladder. Jacob's Ladder, you've all seen it if you've seen any railroad pictures of Mount Washington, because that's where all the trains stop and everybody poses for postcards. The next place they get to is known as Skyline. And Skyline is where you now take a right and head towards the summit. You folks may have heard about it either because of an accident in 1967 or more recently an idea to actually build a hotel at Skyline because there isn't one anymore at the summit. So in 1868, they pushed on, went along the ridgeline, got within about 500 feet of the summit, and then it snowed like crazy. They had to leave their tools in the snow. And they had to then come back in 1869, finish the last 500 feet. They opened on July 3rd, 1869. Of course, this Summit House wasn't there. That's the Summit House of the Jitney years, built in 1915. And for those of you worried about not having hotel accommodations either at Skyline or at the Summit, I would remind you that the Appalachian Mountain Club has the Lake of the Clouds hut, and you can overnight there once the pandemic is through. So this was my Jitney years summer playground from 1953 to 1967. It was fairly unique. It's 6 miles in from Route 302. There were no telephones. You had a track phone that went to the Summit, which was basically a military field phone that you rang. And so you'd send the message up to the Summit. They had a phone, they'd call out. We did not have any power. We were off the grid. DC power was generated by a water wheel. Now, one of the things that the I'm trying to do with the Jitney Years Project is not tell the usual Cog story. The usual Cog story involves Sylvester Marsh. And Sylvester Marsh, well, he was from Campden, New Hampshire, born 1803. In 1823, he left the farm for Boston. He sold provisions in what was known as the brand new Quincy Market. He then went to the shores of Lake Michigan in 1833 to supply a village of 300 people called Chicago. He was one of the first meat packers out there. He made a fortune. He lost his fortune, made a second fortune in the grain business. He got sued. He got defended by an Illinois lawyer by the name of Abe Lincoln. He made money. He came back east. He invented grain drying facilities so that we could all have breakfast cereal. And he decided to hike Mount Washington in 1857. And thanks to one of the people listening in on this presentation, who's not a member of your thing, his name is Rob Bermudez Jr. And he decided he was going to track down exactly when did Sylvester Marsh hike up Mount Washington, get caught in a storm similar to the one that killed Lizzie Bourne. That's the Lizzie Bourne monument before the train tracks went through, with a woman sitting on top of the pile of rocks. And Rob figured out that the hike that Sylvester took that made him think about there's got to be an easier way to get up the mountain occurred on August 24th, 1857. He went to the legislature. He got a charter in 1858. There was something called the Civil War that came along. And the usual Cog story includes the pepper sass. It was the engine that he built as a test dummy thing. Is everything okay? I'm hearing noises. Okay. So the pepper sass is your other usual story. And the reason that you folks might have heard about it includes the fact that it crashed in 1929 when the Boston and Maine brought it back to allegedly boost the tourism business. It was a really big deal. They put 250 people in trains ahead of it and had it follow up in the rear. And there's a movie about it. B&M president George Hanauer rechristened it with water from the Lake of the Clouds. There were suitable speeches. Jack Frost was your engineer. Bill Newsham was your fireman. And it proceeded on July 20th, 1929 to head up. It's important for me that that barn over there became our cabin that we lived in. So that was around in 1929. Pepper Sass went back up over the same grade past the Marshfield Station. They got to Wombeck and they decided to keep going. Reverend Guy Roberts, who was the political driver behind bringing the Pepper Sass back, got off to hop a ride back down because he was told that the Pepper Sass would be going back down after it made it up over Jacobs. But my goodness, Jack Frost and William Newsham had a different idea. They wanted to continue on to the top. the railroad people finally got them to stop at Gulf Tank and go back down. The press and the rest of the folks celebrating it went to the summit for a buffet. And that meant that there was no one who got an image of the actual crash as the pepper sass broke a gear. Even though two photographers were on board, there was no image. They were too busy trying to save their lives and their equipment. And Daniel Rossiter of Ludlow, Vermont, a freelance photographer hired by the railroad, dropped off the pepper sass's tender, fell 33 feet at Jacob's Ladder, and was killed instantly. Now, this normally would be a PR disaster. After all, Rossiter left a wife and an infant daughter. She was just 3 months old on the day, the very day her dad died. And that would seem to be like a great PR disaster, but the beauty of it was is that no paying passenger was killed. And it was a record that would hold through the Jitney years. Now, this is not to say that no other Cog employees like Rossiter didn't die, because they did. And many of them did on what was known as the Devil's Shingle or slide board. And the slide board was a quick way to get back down to the base after work. It was also a way for people to check the track. And it worked such that it used the flange of the cog rack to basically strap the board over it. And you would lift up on the handles in order to break yourself on the way down. The track from the summit to the base was a little over 3 miles long. The record time to go from top to bottom was 2 minutes, 45 seconds. That meant they were doing 60 miles an hour in the 1870s. This was the first Alpine slide. It got popularized by the Among the Clouds newspaper that was printed at the top of the mountain. They took this promo photo during the day because most of the slides carrying newspapers occurred about 2:30 or 3 o'clock in the morning in the dark. And then they'd race the newspapers down, throw them on a carriage, race them to Fabian, and then put them on the morning train so that the folks in the big hotels in Bethlehem and other places could read about themselves at the coach parades and other things happening. The other thing to remember is that the Cog Railway was cutting edge technology in many ways. There was an engine called the Falcon on the Mount Washington line, and it landed off the tracks when it was left unattended outside of the Summit House in a gale and was supposedly blown off the mountain and destroyed. So some Falcons crash, some Falcons don't. In terms of cutting edge technology, the Cog also developed alongside the development of photography and you'd have tourists like this woman here with a Kodak Hawkeye taking a picture of her traveling companion looking brave about to assault the high mountain. But in all of the backgrounds of many of these tourist pictures would be these Cog employees. And the question for me became, as I kept looking at all of these Cog Railway photographs, exactly who are these people? What are their names? They work there like all of the folks I knew as a kid. Well, I have been able to figure out that this gentleman is Pat Camden. He was roadmaster from, he started at the Cog in 1872, building the first Summit House Hotel. He safely used a slide board to monitor the track for 60 summers. And Camden is actually related to Jitney's mentor, Mike Boyce. And Boyce was the last of several generations of Boyces and Camdens to work at the Cog. He also worked for the B&M. He also worked for the Grand Trunk out of Newport. And I also know that this guy is British-born master mechanic, John Horn. He arrives in 1873, works 36 years. But again, the question is, who are the rest of these people? Now, once you get into the Jitney years, I can start to identify some of them. In this in these two pictures, you see the son of a surgeon general. You see a Plymouth State student who finished his school teacher training at Linden State College. And you also see several members of the Social Register of Philadelphia and that main line, as opposed to your main lines. But also from New England mainline railroads came veteran mechanics and boilermakers, and they arrive at the Cog as steam is phased out. Guys like Ray Gilman of Lindenville, and diesel starts to take over the, and they came as refugees as the diesel takes over the traction railroads in the valleys. Add to the mix of Philadelphia main line and old railroad personnel and college students and school teachers, you also have the woodsmen who came out of the woods, were skilled. Monsieur Rouleau had little formal education, but advanced skills in the use of timber. He helped build the Marshfield station in 1938 with oxen. He was still there in the early 1980s. And so you have all these tourist pictures. By the way, that is the first summit house built by Walter Aiken and John Dodge. And they had that as a backdrop until June 18, 1908. They were studying to get ready to open up for the 1908 season. The workmen went down. Something started a fire. It burned the summit house. It burned the signal station. It built an engine house. It built the Among the Clouds. It burned the Among the Clouds thing. The only reason the Tip Top House was saved was the train crew that came up actually ripped up some of the ramp so the flames wouldn't spread there. That left a problem. There was no hotel on the summit. And there was also a change in ownership oversight. The Boston and Maine got absorbed by the New York, New Haven, et cetera. And the new president Charles Mellon of the New Haven, New York, and Hartford Railroad, he thought he could double the Boston and Maine business and bring forth fair returns to the New Haven investment in just 10 years by investing millions to expand the tourist business in New England. And Mount Washington was part of that plan. And part of that plan was getting rid of steam and putting in a brand new electric trolley because he wanted to combat the brand new Mount Washington Hotel that had been built in 1903. Now, the electric trolley could only do a 6% grade. So it had to go left out of the base station and then it had to come back right and would be more than 20 miles long. It would go to a brand new hotel at the top of the mountain, the grandest at all. And all of it was going to be electric. Now, at some point, the financials of the B&M, New Haven, et cetera, got weird. And while the route of the electric trolley was well described, the actual plans are missing. In fact, the archivist at the University of Connecticut at Storrs, who tries to look after the New York, New Haven, et cetera, says there's very little documents. And the word was that they were all put into a boxcar, which went out of a rail yard and was never seen again. So where did this railway actually run? And for that, we have to thank this gentleman, Millard F. Clement, in 1912, was getting ready to graduate from Worcester Polytechnic Institute. He had worked at the Mount Washington Hotel and had, as the trolley was a big project just up the road, he went up and ingratiated himself with the engineer, and he wrote a thesis about the design of an electric railway for Mount Washington. And if you go into Millard F. Clement's thesis, you will find some blueprints. And if you spin them on their side, you will find the railroad goes left, stays at 6% all the way out to Castellated Ridge, then comes back along across the Presidential Range to just above the Lake of the Clouds before heading towards the summit. And so the question becomes, this could all have been built in 1913 or 1914. What would Mount Washington look like if that was existing instead of the steam railroad route? Well, I took the blueprint and tried to put it on a Google Maps just so folks could see how big this was going to be. And oh, by the way, it was electric and it was going to be lit. And it was going to go to the summit into this brand new hotel. And the new hotel would be all electric. And the cool thing was, it was built sort of like a bow tie around the summit of the mountain. And you would come out of your rooms and you would look down at the summit. Cool, huh? Anyways, the architect was Robert Chalmers Reamer, and he'd done the Yellowstone Hotel for the design. And the hotel was going to be built of stone and glass. It was going to be 3 stories tall, 100 rooms with a dining room able to serve between 300 and 400 people. The building featured a circular observatory, 150 feet in diameter, and fan-shaped wings, a skylight, and a 310-degree view, the circle built around the summit. And they had no problems taking license with design and flipping the image so they could do postcards to prove it. Now, Mellon's grand plan collapses in early 1913. But before we go, should any of you have found that boxcar with all of the electric trolley plans, please let me know. I'd like to look them over. So it collapsed in 1913, and the only piece of Mellon's project that would be built was the steam pump house to send water to the new hotel at the summit. It's tough to see. It's usually in the background, hardly ever featured, but it was still pumping when the Jitney years were happening. That's our next door neighbor, Harold Adams of the shop crew, running the pump in the 1960s. This is the pump house in 2016, and it was located down where the star was until June 2020, when the pump house was finally raised. The pumps were salvaged, and a rafter from inside the pump house, signed by Gideon Corvo of St. Johnsbury, who shoveled coal and ran the pumps there from July 1919 to September 1929. And that is one of the types of stories that I've been able to track down in my prospography. Now, after it got collapsed in the summer of 2020, the area was leveled. Steel for a brand new 35,000 square foot shop complex was erected. It got closed in, and last week they started pouring the concrete floors. They plan to work on it sometime this winter. Now, the Jitney years occurred during the Teague years. Henry N. Teague, born 1875 on Mount Desert Island, Maine, the son of a sea captain and a Southern Belle, actually hired Dad in 1950. He's a Dartmouth man, class of 1900, part of the first Tufts Business School class of 1901. After a time he spent working for Dartmouth, he decided to get into the hotel business. he went to New York, and then in 1911 to Williamstown, Massachusetts, and the Greylock Inn, a regional business booster and holder of local offices. If you have ever driven on the Mohawk Trail, that was part of Henry's doing. Henry promoted it. He went to the Massachusetts legislature. He went to the New York legislature, said Massachusetts is going to build its section. He went to Massachusetts and said New York is going to build its section, and he got a vote to build it. He actually runs for Massachusetts state treasurer in 1916, and as a Democrat, he loses in Massachusetts. Yes, that's true. But then tours the country for President Woodrow Wilson in 1918 to promote public works projects in the way to employ the veterans of World War I. He then goes down to Florida in the winter. He runs the Miramar, runs the Greylock in the summer. And then in 1927 or 1929, there's this thing called, there was hurricanes, but the market crashed, and Henry had to declare bankruptcy, which made him the perfect candidate to take over the Cog Railway. The Boston and Maine basically said, Henry, here you go. It's a sort of a $100,000 or so bucks, but you can pay us off over time. And he said, I don't have any money to run it. They gave him $10,000 on top of that. And through his promotion and increasing the number of trains and the number of places you could stay at the base station, he starts to make money. He was busy, he was big, he was brusque, and he was the guy who saved the Mount Washington Cog Railway from shutdown in 1931. Along the way, he hires another Teague, Arthur Simpson Teague, who is a distant and really distant relation, no near relation. And Arthur comes to the Cog in 1933, becomes his manager in 1935. He went to Clemson, and that meant that when World War II started, Arthur had to go join the effort. He becomes the head of the 3rd Battalion of the 22nd Infantry Division. He's on Utah Beach on D-Day. He becomes friends with Ernest Hemingway, and he gets to meet General Montgomery when he is awarded the Distinguished Service Order from the British and the Distinguished Service Cross from the U.S. for his exploits on D-Day behind the beaches. He comes home from the war with a bride, Ellen C. Teague, socialite from Philadelphia, a trained nurse. They marry actually on June 6, 1942. And so basically Arthur celebrated his second wedding anniversary by invading Europe for his bride. Arthur Teague's style was to give those who wanted to work a chance to work, and his lack of background checks and references sometimes got him into trouble. Now, Henry will die in 1952, and he hasn't paid off Dartmouth. And Dartmouth basically now owns a railroad and the top of the mountain and all of Teague's ventures. They have Arthur continue to run it. He buys it in 1963. And when he dies in 1967, Ellen takes over and runs it to 1983. They believe that the Cog employees were family, and in August, they would have what would be known as a Cog party. They would schedule the party such that all the trains would be down. They would hire a caterer so the kitchen crew would have the night off. The employees would chip in $2 for the booze, and the party was on. Of course, we had no power. We were 6 miles from anywhere. So we had to entertain ourselves, and the Cog parties featured can-can dancing by waitresses and train crew. Ann Teague is a daughter. Ginger Nye from Philadelphia. Ken Christie from Florida. Babby Landreth from Pennsylvania. Pliny Granger from Massachusetts. We also had Elvira Murdoch. She was a German immigrant, 16-year-old trumpet phenom that played with all girls orchestras into her 30s. She gave trumpet lessons to the Teague's youngest son, Charlie, and like a good sister, Lucy applauded Charlie's efforts with the trumpet. There was also the wives got in the act by singing various songs, the engineer wives taking care of it. And it was all emceed by Jitney himself, who liked to sing, but could only write parodies.
To the tables down at Maury's, to the place where Louis dwells, to the dear old temple bar we love so well. Sing the whiff and poofs assembled with their glasses raised on high, and the magic of their singing casts its spell.
Yes, the magic of their singing, of the songs we love so well. Shall I wasting and mavourneying and the rest?
We will serenade our Louis while life and voice shall last.
Then we'll pass and be forgotten with the rest.
And because Dad couldn't sing it, my sister and I had to take care of that. Yep. 1967 was our last year at the Cog. It was going to be our last year as Jitney's there because Dad had just signed a 12-month education contract to become a principal. But 1967 was also known amongst the Cog family as the horrible year. It started out reasonably well in 67. Art and Ellen Teague went to Europe for their wedding anniversary, 25th. And when Arthur came back in May, June, he started trying to keep that delicate balance between financially taking care of investments to keep the Cog running and also doing the necessary financial investments to support a mainline lifestyle in Philadelphia. But when he came back, he found out that the state from which he was now leasing the Summit House had failed to actually make necessary repairs. In addition, the water tower behind, the water tank behind the Summit House had blown down, so messing up with the drinking water supply. And all of that meant that that summer, guests could not stay overnight at the Summit House, and that ruined a package deal that the Cog had advertised all winter long of come spend $12, ride up at 6 o'clock at night, stay overnight, and come down in the morning. With all that on it, Colonel Teague had a heart attack in June. He got back basically in late July. And on August 4th, 1967, the Railway Board of Directors met. And as Ellen talks about in her biography, Art attended the meeting, but he disagreed with so many of their decisions, the other board members, that the meeting was adjourned. Ellen and the lawyer and the accountant went to the Teague's other place in Guildhall while Arthur went to take a nap at the cabin where the family was living. The cabin was the building originally built to house the pepper sass so tourists wouldn't steal parts off it in the 1930s, and it had been converted to employee housing. And the reason that Colonel Teague and his family were living there instead of in the hut that had been built in the 30s and expanded in the 40s by Henry Nelson Teague was because the hut had burned on Halloween night in 1965. And in the hut was material that had been being collected for the centennial in 1969. So that is the preface as to why Arthur went back and he killed himself. His body was discovered by his youngest daughter, Lucy. A rock was taken down from the top of the mountain and became his headstone in Lancaster. That was August 4th. 2 weeks later, it was trying to get back to normal and there was a horse show for the Teague girls to attend. And Anne and her boyfriend, Norm Coop, and Coop, by the way, he's the son of C. Everett Coop. She'd worked in the gift shop. He'd run the three all day. But they were going to go to the horse show in Keene. My sister and Lucy had spent the day doing all the tack. And after supper, they loaded Anne's horse, Lady Rouge, in the trailer. And they also put in Lucy's horse, Black Magic. They took off after dark, 10 or so. And it was on Interstate 93, just before the Tilton exit at Bridge 52, with Lucy and my sister sleeping in the back of the van. The hitch comes off the ball. The car and the trailer rolls into the ditch. My sister goes out the back window and lands in between the trailer and the van. Lucy was thrown out the side window and the van rolled over, killing her. Lady Rouge, the horse, was trapped in a trailer. A state police officer put her down. My sister remembers the gunshot, and Lucy's horse, Black Magic, was also destroyed, and Lucy joined her father in the Lancaster Cemetery in the summer of 1967. My project includes all of this. And of course, the third item for 1967 was the first time that paying passengers died on the Mount Washington Cog Railway. What happened was the engineer failed to see the rail going across the cog gear, which acted as a perfect derailer. It picked the cog up out of the rack and set it over. And then the spur gear climbed up onto this piece of the switch and dumped the engine off the track. The car did not have the spur gear. It got derailed, but stayed on the track and became a 7-ton sled with no brakes going down. It luckily left the track on a trestle that was fairly low and went off the track before it met another car and train coming up at it. The town of Carroll in 1967, for their town report, listed the 8 victims of the wreck. They also listed Arthur and Lucy death in the vital statistics. But hope springs eternal, and Margaret Ellen Teague, Ellen and Arthur's daughter, married Tom Baker just before the end of the year. The Jitney Years Project is supposedly a way for folks to get behind the tourist attraction and learn who the people were and why the Cog experience was for those who worked there for this Colonel Teague and knew and appreciated his management.
If you were loyal, he was loyal. In other words, he took care of the family and looked on the Cog as sort of a big family.
My uncle G.G. Dowling, way back in the 30s, was a good friend of Arthur Teague. And my uncle G.G. was from Beaufort, South Carolina. And of course, he got me the job with Mr. Teague. They were still a good friend. Mr. Teague was still alive back then. Ms. Teague, they must have had about 15 children. I can remember that house they lived in Mount Washington. But yes, I have a lot of fond memories of those two wonderful summers in the mountains of New Hampshire.
I've had help from all of these Coggers who were there during the Jitney years. And as Jitney wrote for one Cog party, in the integral and complex Cog legacy, there are threads of men inseparable, twisted, clipped, tucked, and pulled to form an endless tapestry of the Cog. No man or woman is omitted, although unseen and unsung. If a spike changes to oxide and the driver turns to dust, still the red stain stays, and a new workman will drive with equal vigor a spike to hold a new rail, the last by toil joined with the first. All of these folks who helped me, including Bob Kent of Essex Junction, are gone now. And my project is attempting to put as many of these men and women joined by toil and work together in one pile. Because the Mount Washington Cog Railway is not a prissy, polite, laundered Disneyland style operation. It was the perfect training for me to become a reporter, because I saw a wide collection of characters, and I saw tragedy and comedy. And it was something memorable. I wouldn't be a college professor if I didn't say you should read more about it. If you read all of these items and you take up my offer to have you download the Jitney years, you will be able to perhaps get a better idea of what the Cog was like from many different viewpoints. If you read it, you'll learn that this is Jitney. And there's our friend, Pat Camden. This guy's George Tatum. And I know that because George Tatum's granddaughter sent me the photo, but she didn't have a date on it. And that meant we had to do some photo forensics. And I figured out that the chairs and furniture stacked on the cars would show up in the new 1915 Summit House, promotional pictures later. So this is August 1915, and that's George Tatum's brother Wilbur, and we are not quite sure about this guy. We think it is the manager of the operation, Mr. Spaulding, because only the management on the Cog Railway could maintain a clean shirt like that. So I have a historical database online. You can see whether or not any of your relatives are there. Each of them has a card. And the last question that usually comes up is the cog safe? After the accident in 67, they couldn't find any written instructions about how to operate the item, even though break, fire, and run and the cog from a safe point of view had been produced. So they produced the new rule book for 1968. There would be new employees, there would be new equipment, and there would be new owners. And the new owners replaced the switches with sliding tables so that the cog railway, the cog rack never has to be passed over. So is the cog safe? My answer would be yes. So please help me with the prosopography. If you know of any cog railway employees or were related to any, love to hear about it.
Truly outstanding. Thank you very much, Tim.
Well, you're very welcome. And I probably went too long.
And nope. That's nice.
Not for me.
Not at all. Sorry for
that. I enjoyed the heck out of it.
No, it was really good.
That's yeah, really
one of the
good.
Creative
yeah.
and original programs we've ever enjoyed. That
yes,
was
sir.
Really outstanding. Sorry, I missed the beginning of it.
I wrote it as a kid, and I always knew it was the year before the crash. So it must have been 1966 was when I wrote it with my family.
So, well, your picture on, Jim?
We featured it on tours for 35 years every fall. Never had a client fail to enjoy it. Had some great stories about weird events on it, which we can share someday. But that was a truly fabulous program. And again, I thank you so much. I apologize for my weird disappearance. Zoomed me out and I had to reboot my computer to get back in. But Tim, that was outstanding. Thank you so much.
Yes, thank you very much. You, Tim.
And,
can I ask Tim a couple questions?
Please do.
Of course.
Tim.
Yo.
Jim Murphy here.
Yes,
you probably got tons and tons of it, but back on October 14th of 1956, I was up on top of the mountain with my wife on our second day on our honeymoon, and I got 8mm movies I shot of it coming up the grade up towards the top of the mountain. Is that something you'd like a copy of?
Oh, God, that would be great. Yes.
Yeah,
I've been sort of putting it all in a pile, and I also, because I know you've been... I went to see your performance at Norwich University.
Oh, yeah.
And I've now found a whole bunch of Norwich University folks, including one this week, who worked at the COG. And
nice.
And I also know that you grabbed onto a lot of paperwork in your historical capacity. And this,
couple times.
There were guys like George Stevens on the St. J and LC who built the bridges, who actually ran the COG in the 30s. And there was a whole bunch of folks out of the St. Johnsbury and Lindenville area, as well as Wells River and Woodsville. And so be interested in any stuff from that side of the state, because there's a bunch of folks. Again, you can search Vermonters and all that other stuff. But yes, your honeymoon.
Well, I'll find some way to get it. I know, I think I've copied it once over on the video. So I could take the video and copy the video. I don't know if I can get it onto a DVD for you. But the other question is, when did you work at Channel 3?
Oh, you were there. You were throwing some of my poorly shot 16mm film through the soup. I started.
Okay. I thought I had. Okay.
And we now, came up.
Were you up at the new building, the old building? Were you up
building.
At the old building or the new the okay. new one?
New one.
Okay, from yep, I designed the dark room up there.
And we also came up and ambushed you for the Bicentennial Project in 1990, 89, 90, 91 in there. Because we did the interview next to the ticket office.
So, Jim, did you take anything out of that boxcar?
No, I did. I kept the boxcar all together in my backyard.
I don't think
the only thing I'd have on a Cog Railway would be stereopticon views, which a lot of people have got there, but maybe I've got something you don't have. So we'll see if we can do one of those too.
Well, the thing that would be, there are a bunch of Boston and Maine, St. JNLC, Grand Trunk folks who worked up on the Cog, who may have, you know, pictures of them somewhere. Again, that's one of the things I'm trying to do is to get headshots. And as I'm finding people, I'm finding, well, I didn't realize that there were at least two spies that worked at the Cog Railway. So I foolishly decided I would sort of like DVD extras. Hans Jack Kessler was a brakeman from 1939 to 1941. And I was the Marshfield waitress when I was 4 years old. He went and trained with the OSS. She was very proud of being with the CIA. I'm also trying to identify all the people who died on the slide board. And so if you're reading the 1884 reports in the state, you'll find out that there were three lives lost early in the slide board era. I knew that one of the Signal Corps observers, William Seeley, had died in 1873. I found the names of four woodcutters who'd borrowed some boards, and any one of them might have died. But it wasn't until this past week when I found that a Frenchman was descending rapidly in a heavy mist prevailing. He ran into a locomotive, killing him instantly. I'd heard the story, but I didn't find, you know, when, and I found his name is George Tricot 20. I don't think that's his name because Frenchmen at that point, it mattered whether or not you were an English Frenchman or a French Frenchman. And the other thing I'm trying to track down are Cog kids. And like myself, I've now talked with, and this photo came from Claudina Lopez, the young woman in the hat who was up there in 1940 and 41. She's still alive in Arizona. She was 5 years old. Her mom and dad ran the Marshfield area. And the little girl next to her is Beverly Williams, who's still alive, who I've talked with, and her brother Dan, and they provided much of the photos. But I don't know, and this is the one that drives me nuts. Her name is Mrs. Archibald McLaren. She wrote to the Among the Clouds newspapers. She talks about growing up at the Cog. She may have been there between 1872 and 1884. She never uses her maiden name or her real first name because that's the way it is. And so I don't know where Mrs. Archibald McLaren is or was other than Dundee, Scotland. And so those are the types of mysteries like this one. A car, passenger car blew over on the summit. George Tatum was there, had the photo. So you have to do forensics to figure out when the hell was it. Well, it was after the first summit house burned in 1908. And it was after they had apparently poured the foundation for the next one. But exactly when it is, well, let's look at the back of the damn photo. Oh, please, dear God, write down who's in the photo and what time it was taken, you know.
Wow.
So those are some of my mysteries that still remain. And the fact that you can still, you know, I'm finding weird people that went to the Cog. Hmm.
For a reason.
Well.
So unusual.
Yeah, well, Mike Boyce, my dad's engineer, you know, you get the mainliners, they'd come up. And they had a certain attitude. And Mike had worked with them. And so he's there checking his engine. And the guy goes, you know, I run the main line. Okay, and Mike keeps checking his engine. Says, my engine, your engine would be able to fit in my tender. And Mike's getting more mad, but he's being bad. So, you know, it's one of those where he keeps goofing on Mike's engine. And so Mike finally turns around and he says, well, you bring your engine up here and we'll compare them. Sorry, I realize it's a traction railroad dig.
Great story.
Didn't fit the gauge anyway.
No, as far as the shops, there was an extra rail on the outside.
Oh, really?
Yeah, so they could run the coal up and deliver machinery and stuff.
Yeah, I'm going to have to hang off. Thank you very much, Tim, again. And everybody else, have fun as long as the connection stays open. Excellent. Good night.
Good night.
Good night, everybody.
Thank you very much.
See you next month.
I'm able to stick around as long as you are.
Thank you, Tim.
Thank you, Tim.
Thank you. Tim, there's one guy that I know. He works over Premier Coach, and he talked about he used to fire on the Cog Railway. Name is Joel Say.
Joe Say.
Joel, J-O-E-L. And then his last name is Fay, F-A-Y.
Okay. I don't think I have that.
He still works. He's a dispatcher over at Premier Coach in Milton. You might want to give him a call. Could be a good source of information for you.
Okay. I have a Joel D. Fay in my database, who was a fireman in 1973, who got paid $1.80 an hour. You don't have
that. That could be him.
Oh, probably. Does he have a brother, Marshall?
I don't know that.
Again, I've got 2,634 names.
Wow.
In a database, and that's all available online for you guys to go take a look at. If you email me, I'll send you the links. It'll get, it can get blazingly stupid, the amount of stuff I've got. And so, for instance, this is my page, and if you go in here to the interactive database, go search, and you were asking about a Fay, right?
Right.
So you can find your Coggers, and Joel, 1973, Marshall, 60-67, and Unispace Story, etc. And the one I like to do is on the timeline. Find out what happened on at the Cog on this day.
Yeah.
38, they're mostly down in Florida. Mountains for sale. And the girls are going to the Philadelphia area. And you can also, for instance, on the timeline, here's all the material, the items that happened at the Cog in 1967.
Jeez. And okay. How long have you been working on this, Tim?
Well, it started, this is the first alleged printout back in April of 20, they gave me a sabbatical. And this is, you know, the first printout that I ran around saying, hi, can I send you this and see if people would talk to me about their stuff. And it has worked because I've had people give me, this is the Mount Washington Summit House Register, etc. Oh yeah, that's great, Tim.
Kind of your background breaks it up.
Yeah, anyway, so I've been looking for employees in there. They also, Cog is replacing its 25 pound rail with 100 pound rail, and they're making them into little souvenirs and stuff. And, you know.
Paperweight.
Yeah. But I've also glommed onto the press packet for the 1929 Sass celebration. And on the back of it, like a good reporter, they took notes as to where exactly the Pepper Sass crashed. I found, I've gone through the New Hampshire Transportation Agency files and have copies of their Pepper Sass crash investigation photos. And so I got stuff.
Yeah.
So you see Faye's in Milton, right? Do you have a phone number?
Pardon?
Would you have a phone number for him?
If you call Premier Coach,
okay,
in Milton, and he's a dispatcher,
he probably answers.
Dispatches, it's like 5 a.m. till 1 p.m. So if you call in the morning, you can probably get a hold of him.
All right. And again, it's one of those where I'm asking them all to just tell me, how the hell did you wind up there? What were some amazing stories? Put them all in, and then anybody who wants to read it can
figure out
between the lines what it was like working for a tourist operation.
Yeah. Cool.
Back in 2008, we had our toy train convention in Burlington. And one of the tours was to the Cog Railway. And Tom here was in charge of the tours. He might want to tell you a story about what happened with the Cog.
Yeah, it was the last day of, actually it was the last tour of the entire convention. And I was sitting up at the Sheridan Hotel there, because I always wanted to make sure that everybody got back fine and everything. And I get a phone call saying, you know, I'm thinking, I'm done. Get a phone call saying, I just heard that the train on the Cog derailed, and it was the train that your group was riding on. Oh God, here we go. And so I'm sitting and waiting, and finally the bus shows up. And I figure I'm going to have all these irate passengers getting off the bus. And they all come off, and they all got these big grins on their face. And I said, why, what happened? He said, oh, it was great. We had a derailment. And the coach derailed. So what they did is they ran the engine all the way back down to the base station and brought another train up. Then we had to climb down this ladder onto the ground, and then climb up another ladder to get in the other coach to go down. And the crew was so great, and they were helpful and everything. It was wonderful. And so that always sticks in my mind as far as the last tour of the convention. You know, you figure, it's all over with. And then I hear that. So
that. What year was that?
2008.
Okay.
Yep.
It was last
June. The end of June.
Well, it's that's part of the timeline has breakdowns going back to, they broke a shaft on Jacobs in 1869 and spun it and got it up there on Sundays because they weren't running Sundays because you didn't run on the Sabbath. And they,
right.
The crew had all gone down the mountain to go drinking and the owner.
That you can do on Sunday.
Well, the Cog guys figured out a way to party.
Yeah.
And all of that's in the collection as well.
I just love those board sliders. That thing is crazy.
I've got an entire section on that where I've identified most of the humans.
Yeah, sort of.
Yeah, the
can't imagine going 60 miles an hour down that. Just unbelievable.
Well, it totally fascinated the real politic. folks just were fascinated by the craziness.
Wow.
So.
That was a great show.
Yeah, wonderful.
Appreciated it.
Yeah, right here it was.
Thank you. Just if you want any more stuff, Tim Lewis, Tim.Lewis, L-E-W-I-S, at northernvermont.edu. Just email me and I will start pumping out links and crap stuff. Because right now I'm reorganizing. Before it was 3 volumes and now it's going to be 4 volumes because the appendix has become a standalone.
Oh, jeez.
I get...
Where are you living now, Tim?
I officially, for tax purposes, live in Montpelier. But I take care of the Danville compound that my dad and mom had. So it's a shorter commute to work. And
You said in Montpelier?
I have a house in
Montpelier. You said in Montpelier?
House in Montpelier. And I'm currently speaking to you from the Lewis compound in Danville. And
yep, okay.
My real home is probably Route 2 in my Prius.
Are you up in Lindenville?
Yeah, I teach at the university formerly known as Linden State College.
Yep.
Journalism courses.
Yeah, I gave a talk up there once on the railroad too, up at Lindenville.
Well, there was a... Yep. Whole bunch of coggers that would come out of the Linden experience. So my dad's roommate was the one who got him the job up at the Cog.
I'm working with the Berlin Historical Society, which is actually just outside of Montpelier, because the station in Montpelier Junction is in Berlin. Berlin, and the woman who was ahead of it is just down the road on Junction Road.
Next to the propane storage area.
A new chapter member.
Yeah. Yep, that's it. Yeah, that's right. Yeah. I worked, that's the first station I ever worked.
And it's still standing.
Yes, it is.
Yep.
It's on the original foundation of the first station. There are 3 stations there. The foundation is still the original foundation. It's there.
Well, I think when I sign off, the whole thing goes away, doesn't it? Because I'm the host.
Yep, you're your host.
But I don't want to cut you guys off unless it's...
Well, we used to be cutting around 9, so...
Yeah.
I had to run the other room to get my battery charger on because I was on battery, right. And it started dying on me. That's why I disappeared for a second.
Yeah.
Yeah,
well, good talking to y'all. Good seeing y'all.
Yeah, here. Good seeing you all. Good to see you, yeah. Tony. Thanks for coming.
Thank you. My pleasure.
Always good to have you.
Yes, definitely. Everybody.
And Happy New Year to everyone.
Same to you.
Yeah, Happy New Year.
See you all next month.
See you all next month.
All right. Yep. Goodbye.
Yeah, next month is the one that Laz is giving a talk on the Pullman stuff, and I've supplied him a box full of stuff to do with Pullman on the CV Railway already, so he's already having fun.
Yeah, I'm gonna send him some pictures of the car that's down at the house down in southern Vermont there.
Yep.
Took a bunch of pictures there.
All right. I'm done for the night.
Okay. Good night.
Thanks.
Good night.
Good night.
I'm ending it.